The first writers in residence came to the James Merrill House 25 years ago, shortly after James Merrill's death in 1995. Since then, over 80 writers have visited, staying in his home, a National Historic Landmark, to work on projects of their own. Thanks to Merrill's generosity, the house now belongs to the Stonington Village Improvement Association and is an ongoing inspiration for writers and poets from around the world. For more information, visit our website, jamesmerrillhouse.org. Thank you. So, hi.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Bergen. It is lovely to see the James Merrill hidden study of 107 behind you. It's very nostalgic.
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks so much. So this is my new book. It's called The Math Cameras.
My own novel. It's called These Women.
It looks like this.
Well, the first thing I'll say is all the dreams are actual dreams. There's nothing worse than a fabricated dream. You can always tell.
I normally don't write in first person because of the fact that as soon as you have a narrator, you tend to have somebody listening or there's an implied audience.
I just got to soak up in the atmosphere in that house. You just feel like a writer and you feel like you're part of this tradition in a community, and it feels like the work is important.
Magical things happen when you're looking at Merrill's books.
Well, it was a really, really transformative residence for me. It might sound like a bit of an overstatement, but it really wasn't.
Merrill's really distinct imagination was present in every detail.
Thanks. Bye. Enjoy Stonington on my behalf.
Hello, everyone. This is Willard Spiegelman. I'm a member of the James Merrill House Committee. It's the end of March. Spring is trying to peep through here at 107 Water Street. I'm speaking to you from the top floor of James Merrill's apartment. And beneath me is our current Merrill Fellow in Residence, Kamran Javadizadeh. Kamran was born in Los Angeles of Persian parents, but he immediately went back to the other side and spent the first 18 months of his life in Iran. And then he returned to Los Angeles, where he went to school. And then he came east to Yale for his undergraduate and graduate degrees. You can see he's going back and forth here. There's a lot of movement. And after Yale, he went back to California to teach at Pomona College. And then he returned to the East Coast to teach at Connecticut College down the road from us. And currently, for the past 10 years, he's been at Villanova University in suburban Philadelphia. He's a writer of extraordinary gifts and promise, and more than promise. His new book, coming from Oxford University Press, is called Institutionalized Lyric. And perhaps he'll have some time to say something about that today. And he also writes for a more general, a popular audience in venues like The New Yorker, The New York Review of Books, The London Review of Books, places like that. And he is interested in the range of modern poetry. Today, he's going to talk in really two sections to us. The first section is going to be some readings he is going to do of some exercises that he has been committing here daily in James Merrill's apartment. And he'll tell us about those in a moment. And we'll take time after that for some questions from me and from anybody in the audience who wants to post something in the comments line. And then he'll go on to another part. And this is going to be part memoir about his own Persian family and about poetry and Farsi, one of his languages, and what it's like to be binational, not really binational, bicultural, bilingual, as well as bicoastal. And since we are now on two floors, we might say that we are also coming to you in a bicameral way. So Kamran, please come onto the screen and tell us what you're going to read for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Willard. And thank you everyone for tuning in. It's really quite an honor for me. I can't tell you what it means to me to have lived in this space for the last month or so, to have worked here, to see this background behind me on the screen now as I talk to you today. I want to thank Willard for that very kind introduction, and I want to thank all the people who make the Merrill House program for writers possible. It's a lot of work to keep writers happy, and I just want you to know that it has meant a lot to me to receive that loving attention from you. What Willard said is true. I'm going to be reading today from two projects with some conversation with Willard and hopefully with you all in between. I think that I'm to tell you that if you do have questions for us, you can put them in the comments section through whatever service you're using to watch the stream right now, and we'll try to get to as many questions as we can. The first project that I'm going to read from is indeed from this daily exercise I've been doing since I've come here. I won't say much more about it than that because I think it will explain itself pretty readily in the first entry that I read to you. But I will just say that I'm going to, so that you know how to pace yourself, so listen to me. I'm going to be reading four short installments from this daily ritual I've been keeping since I've been here. And to go along with those installments, I've prepared a slide so that you can look as well as you listen. But without further ado, I'll get started on that project from that first reading. So these installments are dated February 16, 2022. The idea, I guess, is that I will spend each morning here writing freely about a single poem from a volume pulled by not much more than whim from the shelves of 107 Water Street, where James Merrill lived. I've also pulled a record from his shelves and have put it on the player. I'll write while the record plays, by hand, I think, and then put it away. I wonder what, if anything, will emerge, or what the hourglass pressure of the music side A and B might produce. Today, the text is from Merrill's own, The Yellow Pages, and the copy is inscribed, quote, "Sandy, let your fingers do the drumming, James, February, 74. Which means this book was given to the man, Sandy McClatchy, who first showed me this place by the poet who lived here 48 years ago, perhaps to the day. What's playing on the record player is Glenn Gould Plays Bach, Disc 1, the 6 partitas. The sound is scratchy and indistinct. The speakers are in the next room, and I don't know how loud I can play the music. It's 7:14 a.m. on my first morning here. The poem I have chosen, last in the book, The Catch-All. Here you come, poor armoire jolting down the street, mirror in your door, seasick, flashing speechless O's of shock the driver of the open van did nothing to compose. All this in August heat. Once in place, you know no worse or better than to stuff yourself with clothes. A nasty rash of red plastic hooks broke out along your sides. Old times got piled up on your head, kept now through thick and thin. One cold day, when the bedside lamp seemed far too dim to dress by, a light gold oval swung ajar. Dear eyesore, placidly reflecting on your roommate once more left unmade by forms that sprang from him. 1972. The light outside the window, I just looked, is now clear. The water is blue. It's the day. When I first read the poem, I went into JM's bedroom to see if the armoire was still there. Nothing I can find fits the description, which felt like a minor disappointment. I have this desire, generally speaking, to see a written record corroborated by the world. Flipping record. In a way, that desire is everywhere in this experience for me. It feels to me here like I'm living in a poem. It's also, I think, the place I'll begin my other project today, with Bita's memory of the earthquake, imagining it just as a block paragraph of its own, perhaps leading then to another such in which I suggested the change in the poem that my grandfather then made. But enough of that, back to the poem at hand. The final stanza is what I love most of all, where the magic of the poem is. In my initial reading, I think I'd skip past the literal to the point, what I've asked my mother not to do when we translate, by which I mean I'd taken the roommate to be the poet, so that the forms that sprang from him were his poems, including especially this one. The idea was that the poet who read as he wrote, who read what he wrote it, as writing demands, found himself decomposed somehow by the poem he had produced. Its formal coherence and organization made a mess of him. But even if that was where I was meant to get, even if that was the point, clearly in the first place, the roommate here is the bed. And how much better that is. The bed is unmade by the forms. Note the plural now, this is JM and DJ, or whomever, who have sprung from him. Now the human is the coherent form, and their bodies are what have made, what make, every night, a mess of the bed, the form that holds them through sex and sleep and whatever else. Are both readings here? In one, the poet is undone. In the other, he undoes. He is himself whole and blithely unaware. And so it goes, I suppose. There's a theory of art here. Sometimes I can't tell if the music is still playing. The tapping of the radiators is nearer at hand, and a better working machine, maybe. I think I'm near the end. Let your fingers do the drumming. What JM wanted from Sandy as a reader, what he wanted from any reader, to play along, to scan a line, to accompany. The Yellow Pages is a phone book, to dial him up. The piano, I hear, is a percussive instrument. Play it like a drum. March 3rd, 2022. Well, today for once, I woke up knowing what I would write about and with a good idea even of what I would listen to. It's James Merrill's birthday. He would have been 96 years old. It occurs to me that this is now the stretch of birthdays that even had he not died prematurely, at what, 68, a month or so before 69, he might not have lived to see. There's something melancholy even in that, the shadow life, the life that might have been, reaching its own end. In practical terms, this must mean that not many of his actual contemporaries are alive anymore. It does feel different to be in the house today. I'm 44, will turn 45 while I'm here. And yesterday proved, I pulled a muscle while out for a run, that I am not 25 anymore. But I'm not here to write about me. The poem is from JM's The Yellow Pages, again the copy inscribed to Sandy, which I can remember seeing on Sandy's shelf in Stonington when I visited him there 19 years ago. Birthday. Beloved dog, in from the wet, reeking of earth, licking my face like a flame. Your red-brown coat and glowing eyes, clearer than anything in human nature, tell me I will live another year. 1967. On JM's 21st birthday, he wrote to Kemen Fryer that his ritual was to listen to the Rosenkavalier waltzes to welcome the new year in. Well, I couldn't find an album of just the waltzes, though he has at least three recordings of the whole opera. I didn't want just a single disc from one of those, because which I wouldn't know, and have instead settled for Der Rosenkavalier Highlights, which for all I know contains none of the waltzes. Well, it's the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra anyway, which seems good. Though Highlights is sounding like arias, and those aren't waltzes, are they? It's fine, it's fine. If JM really did write this on or near his birthday in 1967, he would have turned 41. According to Lanny's biography, I'm cheating. I have it open here in front of me, with Sandy's notes, notes for the letters, and irises laid in. 2 months before this birthday is when Strato had broken his heart, telling him he was engaged, the woman pregnant. And then he was bound to teach at Wisconsin in spring 1967. So perhaps he woke up on that birthday in Madison, no dog there, presumably. Except Lanny also tells us that J.M. won the National Book Award this year for Nights and Days, his first major prize. Quote, I could only think, let me give it back. Let me have Strato instead. The ceremony was March 8th. I've wondered which dog, beloved dog, this is. A dog from memory, an Irish setter, I'm guessing. I could keep hunting through the biography, but let it be that. A dog from childhood, and a man just entering middle age, remembering that dog's kisses and coat and eyes. Truer than anything in human nature certainly resonates differently in light of the perceived betrayal from Strato. Of course, the dog's loyalty and all that, but then also memory is more loyal than life, more fit. I don't have as much time as I thought I did, or rather the writing and music is filling more time than I thought it would. I have a doctor's appointment to get to for this leg. Funny, today of all days. If the dog is a memory, what's shocking to me now, rereading the poem, is how real and present, how embodied it seems. The smell, reeking of earth, the glow and brightness gathered in its presence. Another trip around the sun. Accomplished is what a birthday marks, but promised is what the dog offers with its presence. More years, another at least, perhaps to another book and another prize. I remember reading this poem for the first time a couple years ago, or maybe even one year ago. But what I remember is how my sister was still alive then. How I knew that nothing like this could be promised. I liked reading it all the same. Like to be told that there are things in which we can put our faith, whether dog or poem or whatever words we find. Now do I feel the same? The question, I suppose, is whether something remembered can still feel alive to me, can promise not just its presence now, its smell and touch, but a future, at least one more year, and a body that will come along for the ride. I don't hear waltzing, but I do have to go. Later today, I'll go visit his grave. Last night, I dreamt my grandfather was there, and leave something for him. What can the things of this world, or our memories of worlds we've known, tell us about the world to come? I feel a kind of terror about it, I admit. Really, I guess this is a question about reading something, a text, or object, and then writing about it. A conjecture, always, and yet to do it, we must treat it as an article of faith. March 5th, 2022. I feel as though I'm hitting my stride on the other project, and today I made this choice, the choice of book, I mean, more easily than has been my recent habit. The book is The Woman on the Bridge Over the Chicago River, a book of poems by Alan Grossman, published by New Directions in 1979, with a foreword by Robert Fitzgerald. I see no evidence, really, of its having been read by J.M., none of his occasional penciled markings, etc., but the book was a gift to him, perhaps a belated birthday gift, for Jimmy, Love Fred, March 20, 1980. So the following day, I turned 3, still no English, I think, or maybe just beginning. Today is my mother's birthday. Two waters. I remember two waters. One leaf brown from the sink pump, soft, for washing, not drink. The other clear, one pail, a whole day's good light. The brown water was rain on dark days and windy nights of its own weight downfallen on roof or driven against wall. Sunk then to cistern dark and darkened among leaves, heaved up by hand pump to wash a man's dark hair, and thrown out like fluent grief on the sheep-bitten funeral home field. The other water they sent me out for, each staggering pailful like a great lens raised to a great light. Hard water for drink. No grief or ease in it, as I think now. Unhindered brightness of the deep stored snow. For music today, I once again chose Bach. Julian Breen, guitarist, J.S. Bach Lute Suites, numbers 1 and 2. The liner notes say something about how people might object to playing something meant for the lute on guitar, but how one mustn't be a purist, how Bach himself was not a purist. Well, no purist here, though clearly I understand the impulse. It's just that it's bound to fail and restricts you besides. Even as I write the lines above, I see that they offer a kind of allegory of the poem, itself an allegory. Time to flip the record. As I open the book again just now to look at the poem, the green sticker on its spine, which indicates an inscription, leapt off the spine and into this journal, where it stuck to the next page so securely that it took me a minute and some effort, laughing, to lift it off the page and reattach it to its proper place. Another allegory, I guess. As for the poem, one water impure, the other pure. The first seems of this world, soft, dark, mournful, like fluent grief. Throughout, but especially there, you could have fooled me into thinking this poem was by Seamus Heaney. The water falls as rain and proceeds into its use easily enough, to wash a man's dark hair, an oddly specific and yet vague line at the same time. His father, why not say so? But why only a man's dark hair anyway? The pure water is its opposite and itself full of paradox, heavy but clear, heavy but full of light, transparent, like a great lens raised to a great light, lovely and odd image and phrase there, and yet meant to go inside of us, to be drunk where it is dark. And the water is the product of a slow process, both in its retrieval and in its transmutation from snow. The allegory? Two kinds of writing, I'm inclined to say, prose and poetry, perhaps in part because I'd only ever read Grossman's prose. You can see how he wants, on the one hand, a kind of critical mode that can make things, make ideas into things, as though in a lyric mode. And I suppose the inverse, obverse, converse, I can never keep them straight, is to want poetry that is capable of being essayistic somehow about this world, even if only then to lift this world up onto the page where it becomes a different thing, a thing of its own. The two waters must also be a biblical allusion. The rivers in Eden, right? I realize I'm acting out Bishop's uncertainty about this fact in Santarem, a poem about two rivers coming together. And then there are the two waters of my writing, life at the moment, this project and the other one, which is which? This is the dark water, the easy one, not fit for drinking, the other distilled by the work of time and heavy to lift. But then the real hope is that the rivers might join somewhere, somewhere down the line. And I'll read one more installment from this project, March 6th, 2022. I spent the longest time this morning searching for something I could not find. Like I had the idea of the poem I wanted in mind and just kept paging through books looking for it. For some reason, I thought something 17th century would do, a clever conceit and twisted form and constraints placed on hot desire. But the anthologies that seemed promising turned up nothing in the end. Though there was a classicist, exhaustive manual of classical erotology, which was amusing and diverting. And then I found myself reading around in Christopher Smart, around his cat Jeffrey from Jubilate Agno, which is the only portion of the poem I'd ever read. Why did nothing quite satisfy? And I felt the morning slipping away, foggy out there. In the end, I've pulled Linda Gregg's Alma, some of whose poems I've read, and it's a book I've given, but don't myself have. A short poem near its end, Adult. I've come back to the country where I was happy, changed. Passion puts no terrible strain on me now. I wonder what will take the place of desire. I could be the ghost of my own life returning to the places I lived best. Walking here and there, nodding when I see something I cared for deeply. Now I'm in my house listening to the owls calling and wondering if slowly I will take on flesh again. The book was published in 1985. No sign of Merrill's hand in its pages, no inscription, no sign of its having been read at all, really. But here it is. This morning's music is Brahms, with Kathleen Ferrier as the contralto and the London Symphony Orchestra playing. It's a warm sound coming in from the other room, or was, as now it's time to flip the record. For some reason, I'll just trust it. I want now to record the fact that in the Everyman Minor Poets of the 17th Century that I consulted earlier this morning, given by Freddie Buechner to J.M. in 1947, 21st birthday, someone, I think J.M., has written on the back leaf, quote, "Read this with care, for many times it has been foretasted in my mouth and in my mind rehearsed," end quote. Maybe it's Freddie's hand, hard for me to tell them apart. An exciting admonition to the reader, as such things go. It's the burden I've tried to relieve myself of here, but maybe it's the tension between that attempt and my inclination that keeps me going. I wonder what will take the place of desire. The line seems, in the context of the poem, to come at a time when one is returning to one's life after some kind of intense affair. And the premise of the first line seems to be that life to which one returns had been a happy one. Faint praise. Here is the way desire and the experience of its fulfillment unmakes a person, in the sense of leaving them disengaged from the life that had formerly satisfied them. That first line break from happiness reported in the past tense to a change now in the present. I wonder, following this line of thought, if every line break does this, thematize the leaving behind of experience, the return to the original position, flush left, but one line further down the page, in this way. What Winnicott says about always starting the work again, maybe. But the paradox gestured to here is that to have the word made flesh, as Crane said he felt walking across the Brooklyn Bridge with Emil Ofer, is to make a ghost of you in whatever comes next. And each line, if written well, if made real, leaves the next one hauntingly empty. Thank you.
Kamran, that was delicious. I would ask you for more, but I have questions for you. I don't see that anybody has logged in with a question. Maybe Thomas can let us know if there's something out there that I haven't seen, but I sure have plenty of them. So let me ask you two. One is a very general one that occurred to me at the very beginning, and one is a very specific one, which occurred to me at the end. The relationship between chance and choice, which is part of this daily ritual of yours, it's like the one that Merrill depends on in his experiences at the Ouija board. And I wonder whether you're nodding. I wonder whether this occurred to you as an appropriate thing at the same time. And more generally, to comment, if you can, on the relationship between what Keats called the magic hand of chance and any artist's determination to make something of that which he either chose or was given? That's the general question. Uh-huh. Contemplate that for a second, and I'll give you the specific question, and you can answer that in whichever order you wish.
I'm going to jump in, but go ahead. Yes, please.
The second question is, in the last pairing especially, you didn't say much about the relationship of the Brahms songs that Kathleen Ferrier was singing, and she's one of the great contraltos of the 20th century who died tragically young, and the specific connection to the Linda Gregg poem. So I'd like to hear more about that. You can take either number one or number two or in any order you wish.
Well, in a way, I think the questions are related, Willard. So let me just say what comes to mind as it does. I had the idea for trying something like this project when I got here. I thought, well, I'm here to work on an essay, which it's the one I'll be reading from later, but I thought it would be nice to have something else to do in the mornings as a kind of ritual, almost as a kind of warm-up for me, as a kind of exercise. And gradually this idea came to me. And then I thought to myself, because at first I thought, well, I will literally pull a book off the shelf entirely randomly and I will write about whatever I see there. And then I started to worry and I thought, well, what if I don't like it? Or what if I have nothing interesting to say about it? I don't want to be stuck writing about something that doesn't speak to me in any kind of way. And on the way up to Stonington, I stopped and had lunch with someone who's already come up here, my old teacher, Lanny Hammer, and asked him what he thought of this project. And he said, well, it won't be random exactly, will it? And I thought, no, that's right. It won't be precisely random. And I thought, oh, yes. And actually, the same connection that you've thought of, Willard, came to me in that moment, that something would be guiding me in making the choice. But it would be interesting not to interrogate what that something was too closely. That is, to leave that shrouded in a bit of mystery. I thought that would be kind of productive for me. If I'd read more of the or others in installments from the project, you'll see that I wrestle with this problem in the process of writing these entries. That is, I have a tendency to belabor the choice, to pull a book off and say, no, this isn't quite right, to put it back. And I can easily lose an hour of day just reading around for what feels exactly right that morning. And I'm trying to impose on myself a kind of constraint that will prevent that from happening so that I can write about whatever's in front of me with the idea that whatever it is, I will be able to make something of it. And so there is a kind of balance for me between, as you say, chance and choice. It occurs to me that in a way, I'm just rephrasing the very interesting point that you made or that you asked as a question, and I'm saying, yes, that precisely that tension is what has appealed to me. I suppose because it creates for me a version of the same kind of productive tension that an artist or a poet might feel when working within a kind of received form. That is, that there is a kind of constraint there within which one can move freely. And you might think that if you remove the constraint, the freedom would be even greater. But paradoxically, I think one finds that sometimes with the right kind of constraint, it can be the condition that produces the experience of freedom. And that is very much the experience I've had here. With respect to the music and your more specific question about the Linda Gregg and the Brahms, I've spent my life now, or my adult life anyway, studying poetry. And it's not a perfect match, my area of expertise and what's represented on Merrill's shelves, but it's a pretty good match, which is just a long way of saying, I know some of the poems before I read them. And I have a kind of place in my mind to deposit them, even if I don't know that poem itself very well. With respect to the music, that's just not true. In many cases, I'm listening to something as though for the first time. I don't have anything like your knowledge about what the music is that I'm listening to. I'm afraid to play it too loudly because I'm working in the morning and I don't want to disturb neighbors and that kind of thing. So the music is playing very much of a kind of supporting role for me. Occasionally the pieces assert their presence. I'm sure that I'm missing all kinds of opportunities to say something interesting about the relationship between the music that I've chosen. But I will say my relative lack of knowledge about the albums that I'm pulling from the shelves and putting on the record player makes that choice much easier for me in the morning. That's a quick choice. I go to Merrill's collection of hundreds of records. And, I will go so far as to think, well, I know what Bach piano pieces sort of sound like. Do I feel like I'm in the mood for that? Yes, no. Do I want something choral? Do I want a symphony orchestra, or do I want a piece of chamber music? I can get that far, and I have some sort of rough sense of what different composers sound like. But beyond that, I'm really not I'm really not thinking very much about what it is I'm putting on the record player. And occasionally the record player does show up in the pieces themselves. But you know, part of the idea for me, Willard, and I'll say this is just the last piece and we'll see if we have other questions, is that from the beginning, one of the main purposes that the putting the album on was serving for me was as a kind of hourglass, you know, as a timekeeper and another kind of constraint thereby. So you'll see that I have started to note, oh, when it's time to flip the record and that kind of thing. And I have a sense of now that's been ingrained in me after many days of practice of about how far I can get before the record needs to be flipped, about how many minutes it takes me to produce a piece of writing of a certain length. So I don't know if I've answered your question, but I've talked around it a fair bit.
No, you have quite well. I'm afraid we're going to have to go on to the next half because we're beyond the halfway point already. I would simply make one observation that I thought when you were putting on Rosenkavalier, you would be aware of the fact or make much of the fact that the central theme or one central theme in the whole opera is the passage of time.
Yeah.
And the Marshalin, the main character, is worried that the time is ticking and she's getting older. Mm-hmm. And it would be such an appropriate theme for somebody like Merrill.
Yeah.
For whom that is a great theme and a great concern. We now have 25 minutes to go. I'm glad nobody else has asked a question. Tell us more about the project involving your grandfather and his extraordinary poetic history and how it came to you and your mother and the translation project that you're engaged in with this.
Well, should I set it up very briefly, Willard, and then dive right in? Do you think that would be best? Or would you? Let's do that then. So, okay, well, thank you very much. This is a very different kind of piece, although, you know, those of you who are listening carefully might note that I occasionally referred to it in the progress of the installments that I read from the other piece. But so this is an essay. It should take me about 20 minutes to read the excerpt that I've chosen for you here. Which is, I think, though the essay isn't finished, perhaps a third of the length of the piece as a whole. So it's a long essay. The title of the essay, for now anyway, the working title, is Making Contact. And the essay is dedicated to my sister, Bita. Not long before she died, I asked my sister what she remembered of our departure from Iran. We left for good in the fall of 1978. Bita was 6 years old and I was one. Her memory was hazy. I think there was an earthquake, she said, just before we left. I remember looking at the swimming pool in the little courtyard behind our house. I remember the water sloshing over the edge. It looked so strange. I have in front of me here, more than four decades later, the American passport I used on that journey. I had been born in California, which made me a citizen of the US before we returned to Iran for my first 18 months. The photograph inside is of a baby, looking placid or bewildered, I can't tell, and bears the embossed imprint of the American Embassy in Tehran. The entry stamp from US Immigration in New York reads September 24, 1978. I type 1978 Iran earthquake into my search bar and learn that on September 16th at 7:05 p.m. local time, there was a violent earthquake in the town of Tabas. Many thousands of people died. Another search tells me that the sun set in Tehran at 7:41 p.m. that evening. It was dusk then, when the seismic waves traveled through the surface of the earth the nearly 400 miles from Tabas to Tehran. A minute or so after the shaking began in central Iran, my sister saw the water begin to lift over the edge of our pool. Half an hour later, the sun had set. What had she seen? In the middle of a warm, late summer night, 25 years earlier, my mother was startled from sleep by the sound of soldiers leaping down from a truck and onto the street outside her home. This was Tehran, 1953, she was 8 years old. During the summer, she and her siblings, six sisters in all, soon to be seven, would often sleep on a row of mattresses laid out across their roof. Four sisters were home that night. Sohra, the eldest, who was 18, Parveen, 11, my mother Malak, and Matoh, 6. Their mother, Sara Samet, we called her Maman, had taken her youngest daughters, Mavesh and Mashid, with her to visit their uncle, her brother, in northern Iran by the Caspian Sea. She was pregnant with what would be the last of her children, my aunt Shohra. The girls who'd remained in Tehran were home with their father. His name was Akbar Pilavar. We called him Aghajun. The first words my mother heard that night, after the sounds of the truck pulling up and of boots hitting pavement, were spoken by Zohra to their father, Aghajun, Umadan. They've come. The younger girls scrambled out of their makeshift beds and peered over the edge of the roof. Below, they saw men with machine guns at their door. Zohra raced downstairs. When, just a minute later, she came back up to the roof, two things about Zohra had changed. She was now wearing a long and heavy cardigan tied tightly at the waist, and in her arms she was carrying folders stuffed with papers. She told my mother and Mahtoch to get back in bed and slid the folders under their mattresses. Boro Bechab, she told them, go to sleep. The girls did as they were told. They shut their eyes while their big sister, already half their father's age, joined him downstairs to let the soldiers in. Over the years, and despite everything that happened next, Aghajun enjoyed telling this part of the story. He had made a mistake, he said, before going downstairs. He had changed from his pajamas into proper clothes, shirt, jacket, slacks. When he opened the door, the men, I think they must have been from the Second Bureau, Iran's military intelligence agency, asked why it had taken him so long. We were asleep, he said. Well, why then was he dressed? He had no good answer. It looked as though he'd been expecting them. They searched his room, a bedroom that doubled as his study. The walls were painted a pale blue. A red rug, nothing fine, sat in the middle of the room. Beside his wooden desk, a small metal bookcase with a glass door, behind which were volumes of Persian poetry. Classical poets like Rumi, Sa'di, Hafez, and moderns too, like Muhammad Taqi Bahar. Years earlier, while giving a poetry reading, Bahar had told the audience that he knew my grandfather's poems and that he, my grandfather, reminded him of his younger self. That story got repeated. On Aghajun's desk would have been an ashtray, always, and a black manual pencil sharpener, which years later, my sister gave to me and which I now use. Across the room was the bed Aghajun shared with Mama. Beside the bed, a single nightstand piled with books, Russian novels translated into Farsi. Atop the books, a notepad and pen, a window onto the street below. On the wall, a wooden plaque commemorating lines from another modern poet, Muhammad Farrokh Yazdi. Quote, the brave man must hold a sword in hand and take his rights from the mouth of a lion. Yazdi was a socialist. According to one legend, as a young man, he recited a poem denouncing the Shah. Local officials were sufficiently alarmed that they threw him in prison and had his lips sewn shut. In my grandfather's bedroom, the officer who seemed to be in charge read the Yazdi line aloud and smiled. He turned his attention to Zohra and, noting her heavy sweater and the warm weather, asked her, his eyebrows raised, whether she was very cold. Yes, she said, I've caught a cold. He nodded. On the stairs that led to the roof, each girl had a box where she kept books and papers, personal things. Parveen, who had followed her older sister and father downstairs, saw that on top of her box, she'd left a sheet of paper containing lyrics to a song. One of the soldiers noticed it too and lifted it out for inspection. We are the red roses of the garden of our country, the song began. We spread happiness and delight in every direction. Quietly, he placed it back in her box, this time hiding it beneath her other things. My mother was on the roof and still in bed. She heard footsteps coming up the stairs. When she peered through half-shut eyes, she saw soldiers, guns drawn, beside her bed and on the neighbor's adjoining roof, standing guard. More footsteps and voices. One of the men from the roof called down, "We've already searched up here. Don't bother." They hadn't searched, though. They hadn't found the papers beneath the sleeping girls. And then they left. Avajun told Zohra that they'd been lucky. The one in charge had been on their side, a leftist, Chappie, a good man. But there would be others, he said. A short time before the night of that raid, nobody with whom I can still speak remembers whether days or weeks separated the two events, there had been a coup. On August 19th, 1953, 32 Sherman tanks rolled through the streets of Tehran, where they encircled the headquarters of government staff, the telephone telegraph building, the radio station, and by evening, the home of Iran's prime minister, Mohammad Mossadegh. Earlier in the day, Mossadegh had authorized those same tanks to leave their barracks in order to restore order in the city. In fact, most of the crowds on the streets that day had formed in response to an attempted coup that Mossadegh, acting on a tip, had thwarted just 4 days earlier. A much smaller and more violent group had also taken to the streets in support of the Shah, Mohammad Reza Pahlavi, who had fled the country when the earlier coup failed. That group, we now know, had been paid off by the CIA. We also know that it had been the CIA and its British counterpart, MI6, that had orchestrated the initial attempt to unseat Mossadegh. When that attempt failed, Loy Henderson, the American ambassador in Tehran, noted that American lives were in danger and demanded that Mossadegh clear the demonstrators from the streets. Mossadegh obliged, and the tanks he dispatched to restore order instead, executing a plan devised by the Americans and the British, turned on their own prime minister. By the end of the day, dozens of people had been killed and Mossadegh and most of his ministers arrested. 3 days later, the Shah returned to Iran. He ruled until 1979. As prime minister, Mossadegh and his party, the National Front, had in 1951 nationalized the local assets of the Anglo-Iranian Oil Company, the company now known as British Petroleum, which until then and for nearly half a century had extracted Iranian oil on outrageously favorable terms to the British. Beyond the immediate loss of revenue to British coffers, both Great Britain and the US feared what Mossadegh's actions, if they prompted a global trend towards oil nationalization, would mean for Anglo-American interests around the world. By the summer of 1952, among the many sources of support for Mossadegh was Hezb-e Tuda, Party of the Masses, Iran's Communist Party. The heyday of Tuda had been the 1940s, when it secured several seats in Iran's parliament, won major reforms in labor law, and enjoyed broad popularity throughout the country. But in 1949, with the party in a weakened state, the Shah had outlawed Tuda, which then had to survive underground. In both Britain and the US, the Tuda party's eventual support for Mossadegh, whom many in the party had formally dismissed as an imperialist stooge, remained a convenient cover story. Colonialist designs on Iranian oil could be framed as Cold War containment of Soviet influence. One of the first things the Shah did when he returned to power was to renew his crackdown on Hezb-e Tuda. My mother remembers her father saying after the coup, "Mubarizeh tamum nashodeh," the fight is not finished. Avajun was a member of the Tuda party. On the day of the coup, his nephew Hushang, the son of Maman's older brother, came to his house with an empty suitcase. Together, the men burned documents, newspapers, and books, and packed still others, including books of poetry, into the empty suitcase. Hushang then took the suitcase and two of his young cousins, my mother and her younger sister, Matur, with him to their aunt's house, their father's sister, an hour away. Ordinarily, they take a bus. That day, they took a cab. 8 months after the coup and the nighttime raid that found nothing, on April 30th, 1954, June was arrested for speaking at a meeting in Varamin, a small city an hour or so southeast of Tehran. He was brought first to a military prison, where he was told to renounce the party and to declare his loyalty to the Shah. When he refused, he was beaten. When he continued to refuse, he was moved to Ghas, a Qajar-era palace that had been remade into a prison and torture chamber during the reign of the Shah's father, Reza Shah. He was held there, away from his wife and daughters, for 7 months. Avajun continued to write poems while he was in prison. Given the reason for his arrest and the content of his poems, that was an almost unthinkably dangerous thing to do. He ends the first of his prison poems, called From Behind Bars, by addressing the interrogator who beats him and demands he sign a letter of renunciation. Quote, "And are you unaware that 5 years ago, I made a promise and at its foot wrote my name in blood? The hatred to which you ask me to admit, hear it right now. Hate to the traitor Shah and hate to the crown and throne. Hear it now, for it is hard. Hate to what's left of your damn work, the palace and the kingdom. Long live the creating power of the people, your destroyer here and now." The scene of his writing is something I can only dimly picture, though its evidence is as real as anything that sits on my desk today. I don't know how he hid the composition of the poems from the prison guards and interrogators, but I do know how the poems survived. My mother remembers being a young girl, 9 years old by then, and watching her mother, Maman, bring Arjun's laundry home from prison. Before washing his clothes, Maman would carefully unstitch the seam around the waist of his pajamas. She would then pull narrow strips of paper from the waistband, and when she was done, roll those strips up, almost as though they were ribbon or film, and store them away for Arjun's return. Then she'd restitch the seam, a kind of Penelope in reverse, it now seems to me, and wash and return her husband's clothes. It would be 40 years before my mother saw those poems again. The impression I have of my grandfather, a mosaic formed over the years from my family stories, women's stories, I now see, my mother, my aunts, my cousins, is of a proud and meticulous man. He would fold his newspaper just so as he read it, then file it away when he was done. If you moved a pencil on his desk, he'd know upon his return. We have letters that he sent to our family in the US many years later, even the margins filled with careful, gorgeous script. When he was 18 years old, living in Rasht, the city of his birth in northern Iran, already married and with a baby daughter, he sent in an application for an editorial job at a Tehran newspaper. He was invited for an interview, but when he showed up in Tehran, nobody believed that such a young man could have written those stories. The editors asked him to sit down and write that night's editorial while they watched. He did, and they hired him on the spot. As a poet, and notwithstanding a politics that could be described as revolutionary, Arjun favored traditional meters and strict forms, even as he could see happening around him Iran's great era of modernist breakthrough and free verse experiment. I don't know, nobody does, whether Arjun composed his prison poems on narrow strips of paper that emerged at home from his waistband, or whether he cut his sheets of paper to ribbons after he'd filled them with ink. Either image conjures for me an almost unfathomable pathos and intensity, a concentration of purpose and commitment to the world to come that leaves me speechless. Over the 7 months of his imprisonment, the tone of the poems changes. The earliest poems projected righteous defiance, but by the end I hear something more like despair. Just before his release, he wrote a poem called Last Message, addressed not to his interrogators, but to his daughters. Here is how it begins. O little stars of the revolving dome, O little moon-faced daughters of mine, O seven signs of the spectrum's seven colors, seven new verses from the color and smell of mine. Although I cannot see your face, spit beyond mine, yet sit and unveil this hidden secret of mine. Today, but for you, there is no one to see this face of mine. There is no one by my side to console me, to give his heart to this heart of mine. When, eventually, he was released from prison and came home, he made fair copies from his scraps, annotating them, and I'm sure tinkering as he went along. I think he must have burned the strips of paper that he'd sewn into his clothes. And so this meticulous man sent his words into the future by cutting them to pieces and reconstituting them on the other side. His poem left the prison cell that held his body. They left literally woven into the fabric that once touched skin, and married woman with whom he had made a family, they entered the home where that family lived. Once, my mother remembers, there had been a mix-up at the prison. Maman held the clothes she brought home from the prison to her face and said to the girls, "In le basse babat nist. These aren't your father's clothes." How could she tell? "Babu," she said, "by the smell." The rest of the time, then, my grandfather's clothes brought with them into the home, both his words and a trace of his body, as though the words themselves had been secreted with his sweat. While their father was in prison, the girls who had seen their cousin Husheng arrive with the empty suitcase, who saw their mother unstitch their father's clothes and pull his words from their seams, would play with his empty cigarette boxes. They'd pretend to be married to imprisoned heroes of the party. Then they'd stuff the boxes with secret papers and hide them throughout the house. And I'm looking at the time, and I think I better end there. So I'll pause and invite Willard to join us again.
Thank you. I apologize to everyone in my mechanical ineptness. I hadn't noticed that, in fact, there were comments and questions, which we can't deal with now. These were all about the exercises. Many of them were oohings and ahings of praise from your admirers. One of them was an actual question that you will be able to answer the asker thereof in an hour when we go out to dinner.
Okay.
But let me end with two questions, really. One suggested by our friend Lanny Hammer, which is, how did you celebrate the Persian New Year last week? Can you tell us?
Sure.
What have you done for that?
I can tell you a little bit about it. Yeah. So Persians and many people throughout the Persian world celebrate New Year on the first day of spring, and so it's a time when we celebrate new life, and we do so generally speaking by setting a table that we call a hafsin, which contains various symbolic objects, all starting with the letter S in Farsi. It was symbolic of this idea of new life. And I have one such that I started here. So on a plate that belonged to James Merrill, I grew these lentil sprouts here. We call this sabze. So this little sign of green life. So that was one thing I did to celebrate the Persian New Year. Felt nice to do so in this home.
And one final question, both you and of course James Merrill, our poets, all poets, are devoted to language, but you especially are devoted to different languages. I wonder how your Farsi is progressing.
Well, there's a very long answer to that question, which conveniently I don't have time to give.
You have 3 minutes.
Okay, I'll give a short version. Farsi was my first language, and was very quickly displaced in early childhood by English. You know, I was briefly bilingual, you know, truly bilingual. And then, you know, I was just talking with my mother and father, who probably feel very guilty and embarrassed about this now, at dinner last night. But, you know, people started to laugh when I would make little slips between the two languages. And I was a very proud boy. And so when I was about 3 or 4 years old, I started to refuse to speak Farsi, though I went on understanding it as a native speaker. And it took me many, many, many years, more than I'm prepared to admit right now, before I was able to speak Farsi, particularly to my family again. Our typical pattern was that they would speak to me in Farsi and I would answer in English, and we got along well enough. I'm still illiterate in the language. And so the bits of the poetry that you heard me read from my grandfather, to sort of skip to the point here and to what's truly interesting about this. You know, it's odd. It has struck me more than once that it is odd that I'm somebody who's made a life around writing about poetry and that my grandfather was a poet. But I can't read his poems except with the help of someone. Particularly, it has been with the help of my mother. So what we'll do is we'll sit together and she will read from one of her father's manuscripts to me. And if she reads it slowly enough, I get it, generally speaking. I'll get the gist of it pretty well. I may have some trouble with vocabulary here and there. And then we'll produce together a kind of literal translation into English. Mm-hmm. And then I'll play around with that and try to make it sound like an English poem. So my Farsi, Willard, is very much a work in progress, but it is it's a language that I know on entirely different way that I know, for instance, French, which I studied for many years in school. I can read in French and talk a little bit in French here and there, but I'm always translating in my mind or trying to in French. Farsi I hear as a first language. It's just that I can't produce it. It's as though that side of my linguistic faculties has atrophied or something. And so my hope is that with the kind of emerging that I'll get closer to being a more competent reader and speaker and critic of poetry in Farsi.
Kamran, they call it the mother tongue, and you are clearly proving why that is so. We have to stop. The hour is over. I want to thank you for this very enlightening conversation. And again, I apologize to the people whose questions I didn't get to, but Kamran will see them and be able to answer the comments from those people whom he knows.
Yeah, I will answer. I will answer you all when I read your questions. Thank you for being here, everyone. Willard, thank you for doing this.
A great pleasure. Thank you, everyone. Come back to the JM House and watch us live, one way or another. Thanks.
Writers, apply for this. It's wonderful.
Bye bye.
So hi.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Bergen. It is lovely to see the James Merrill hidden study of 107 behind you. It's very nostalgic.
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks so much. So this is my new book. It's called The Math Cameras.
My own novel. It's called These Women.
It looks like this.
Well, the first thing I'll say is all the dreams are actual dreams. There's nothing worse than a fabricated dream. You can always tell.
I normally don't write in first person because of the fact that as soon as you have a narrator, you tend to have somebody listening or there's an implied audience.
I just got to soak up in the atmosphere in that house. You just feel like a writer and you feel like you're part of this tradition in a community, and it feels like the work is important.
Magical things happen when you're looking at Merrill's books.
Well, it was a really, really transformative residence for me. That might sound like a bit of an overstatement, but it really wasn't.
Merrill's really distinct imagination was present in every detail.
Thanks. Bye. Enjoy Stonington on my behalf.
The first writers in residence came to the James Merrill House 25 years ago, shortly after James Merrill's death in 1995. Since then, over 80 writers have visited, staying in his home, a national historic landmark, to work on projects of their own. Thanks to Merrill's generosity, the house now belongs to the Stonington Village Improvement Association and is an ongoing inspiration for writers and poets from around the world. For more information, visit our website, jamesmerrillhouse.org. Thank you.